Good morning. Can you hear me? Good morning. Welcome back. My name is Hilaire Lemoine. I'm doing my training, and I'm one of the organizers of the conference. It's up to me to have the honor to moderate the next session.
This is the applied version, I guess, of the previous session that we've just had, our two keynote speakers. And we have two case studies on the program, one Kosovo, and the other one Sri Lanka. And we have two speakers, obviously. First, we have the National Commissioner of Kosovo, Mr. Slavisa Mladenovic. I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly. Mr. Mladenovic was appointed Language Commissioner on December 19, 2012. As Commissioner, he strives for the protection, preservation, and promotion of the languages of communities which are not in official language or in official use. Most of Mr. Mladenovic's professional experience was gained while working for the OSCE, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. Thank you for joining us. Our second presenter is Mr. Waruna Wilpata. We are very honored to have with us this morning the Acting High Commissioner of Sri Lanka in Canada. Mr. Wilpata has generously accepted to deliver the presentation on behalf of the chair of the Official Language Commissioner of Sri Lanka, Professor Dissanayake, who unfortunately was not able to be with us this morning. As you probably know, the Official Language Commission of Sri Lanka is a member of the International Association of Language Commissioners. Mr. Wilpata is a longtime diplomat. He joined the Foreign Services of Sri Lanka in 1988. He served in Moscow, in Berlin. 98. I'm sorry. In 1998, so you're much younger than...
I was worried.
I see. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. He served in Moscow, Berlin, and in Havana. He's been now in Ottawa since June 2014. We have asked our presenters to speak for about 20 minutes to allow a question period, if at all possible. I would like to welcome as our first speaker, Mr. Mladenovic. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would also thank the organizers. Needless to say how important this is for us, but I really have to mention that I understood the importance of this kind of events yesterday and today when I had to alter my presentation, because I really felt the need to reflect on some of the topics that we touched yesterday and today. So thank you very much. Thank you to the university for a wonderful event. I will try to present the case study of Kosovo as a post-conflict society, and how do we accommodate use of official languages in a newest European country. To be honest, it is really not fortunate to be a case study. Why did I say I want to reflect on some things that we mentioned yesterday? Because I understood that how relative are some issues, because Canada has the Official Language Act since 69, right? And still struggles in some cases to implement the legislation fully. So there is no surprise in that sense that us as a post-conflict society, only 16 years after a very violent and bloody conflict, are facing some of the issues I will mention today. I will start the presentation with a quote. So it says, once upon a time there were two countries at war with each other. In order to make peace after many years of conflict, they decided to build a bridge across the ocean. But because they never learned each other's language properly, they could never agree on the details. So the two halves of the bridge they started to build never met. To this day, the bridge extends far into the ocean from both sides and simply ends halfway, miles in the wrong directions from meeting the point. This also goes for different ethnic communities living in one society after a civil war, let's call it that way. Due to the ongoing changes in the political systems and democracy, the use of both Albanian and Serbian language has been affected by different political and conflict events. The first part of the presentation, I will focus on short historical background of Kosovo in order to reflect on how languages were used in the past. I will then mention the accommodation of languages and the situation, linguistic situation, in the post-conflict of Kosovo. So this is the map of former Yugoslavia. In order for you to understand the language prevalence in Kosovo, this used to be, sorry for the translators, this is Kosovo. So that used to be the autonomous province of Serbia in the former Yugoslavia. As you can see, the pink area is predominantly Serbian speaking. However, Kosovo itself is predominantly Albanian speaking. So just for you to understand the shift in the predominance in one territory, the role of demographics in that sense. The first move towards the achievement of equality between Serbian and Albanian language was the constitutional amendment of former Yugoslavia in 1969. So, what a coincidence! The same year as in Canada. And right after the adoption of Albanian language as official language in then the autonomous province, in 1970 there were first significant moves toward reaching the equality through the establishment of University of Pristina in Albanian language in 1970. Fully equal status Albanian language got through constitutional changes in 1974. Ever since 1974 until late 80s, beginning of the 90s, the linguistic situation and the implementation of the equality of official languages was rather satisfying in Kosovo. There were media in Albanian and Serbian language. There were universities in Albanian and Serbian language, elementary, high schools. And in my opinion, most importantly, there was learning of the language of the community, of the surrounding in elementary, high school, and post-high school education. However, the 90s were the downfall of Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia fell apart in only a couple of years as a result of violent conflicts. In the late 80s, beginning of the 90s, with the rise of the Milosevic power, the use of Albanian language gradually vanished in the institutions. The the autonomy, the autonomy of Kosovo was retracted. And the guarantee of use of Albanian language in the province was the autonomous institutions. But by the dismantling of these institutions, the language was not officially used anymore. So the language of administration became mainly Serbian. There were cases, of course, of use of Albanian in official documents, but that's mostly sporadic. There were limited media access in Albanian language. Most of the media were in Serbian language. The education was granted by the law. However, Albanians did not accept the Serbian curricula from Belgrade, so they decided they will organize their parallel educational system. Most importantly, in my opinion, learning of languages of majority or minority in the majority and minority schools has ceased. I already mentioned that, sorry. So, 99 comes, and violent conflict. For most of you, you're probably familiar what happened in 98, 99. Many Albanian refugees in 99. Then return of the refugees, displacement of Serbs after the start of the international administration. So a lot of demographic movements in Kosovo at the time. Following the Kosovo War, there has been a reverse in power relations between Albanian and Serbian language. Due to the sheer number of speakers, because Kosovo is now internationally administered territory, so considered a separate territory, Albanian becomes a majority language in that sense, within the new boundaries at the time. Albanian now becomes dominant. In post-conflict environment, language is often used to determine the identity of the enemy, or let's say the former enemy. The way to determine the identity of the other ethnic group, which in Kosovo was very easy because Albanian and Serbian languages are different in its origins. Albanian is one of the oldest Indo-European languages, while Serbian is a Slavic language. The situation after the war was very tense, of course. Kosovo Serbs were unable to use their own language in the streets in everyday life, outside of their enclaves of places where they presented the majority. The similar was also for Albanians, where they were minority in some Serb, mostly populated Serb areas, such as North Kosovo or Serb enclaves. To illustrate the situation on how people felt after the conflict in Kosovo, I deliberately chose a case of an international mission member who was killed in the streets of Pristina in 1999 simply for speaking a language that is too similar to Serbian. A group of youngsters. Asked a UN policeman, what's the time? The person answered in Bulgarian. He was a Bulgarian police officer. He answered in Bulgarian, which is rather similar to Serbian, especially in the numbers and the time. And the group dragged the person and killed him. So you can imagine that the people were really afraid to use their own language in the streets, in the public, and this was, of course, reflected as the lack of demand for the institutions to provide services in both language. In post-conflict context, Kosovo remained deeply divided society with virtually overlapping ethnic and linguistic cleavages. two ethnolinguistic groups, Kosovo Serbs and Kosovo Albanians, lived in the context where language became politicized and long-standing linguistic, political, and social hierarchies of power have been radically disturbed. Language issues have a profound effect in community relations, of course. Serbs have felt uncomfortable leaving their enclaves as they do not speak Albanian, and some Albanians refuse to respond when addressed in Serbian language. However, there have also been problems for Albanians in terms of speaking their language freely in the areas where they were a minority. Despite sharing a normally equal status in the institutions, Serbian and other languages in Kosovo are marginalized in every day in reality, even though Kosovo had a legal framework that provided the equality for languages on the state level. At that time, international administrative level. International administration, of course, understood the necessity for the equality of the languages and the necessity to accommodate the needs of the communities. The first movements towards the officializing the use of language was in 2000 when UN administration adopted the regulation which guaranteed the equal use of both languages and English language, of course. However, that regulation was not properly implemented. I really need to mention also events in 2004, because the situation gradually started to improve since 99. People gradually started feeling free and move more freely, use their language more freely. However, there was a major drawback in 2004, ethnically initiated violence in March 2004, when it was a major setback for the improvement of the situation of languages in Kosovo. The situation of Serbian language was even worse after these events. Of course, the political elite was not perfectly aware of the need to accommodate the needs for the linguistic communities. However, under the pressure of international community, the first law was adopted in 2006. The law provides that the Serbian and Albanian language are equal official languages in the whole of Kosovo, and also provides that languages of other communities are granted official status in some municipalities. The comprehensive proposal for the status of Kosovo prepared by Matti Ahtisaari, Finnish diplomat Matti Ahtisaari at the time, also provided that future state needs to take care of languages and grant Serbian language official status besides the Albanian language, the language of minority. In 2008, Kosovo declared its independence and adopted its first constitution, which also provides the equal status of Serbian and Albanian language. Things gradually started to improve, especially in the feelings of the people to use their language in the public. In some cases, in our public events in Kosovo, I often say, I wish the institutions have reflected the situation in the public, because the people started using languages freely, increasingly in the public. However, the institutions were not that fast in implementing the law on languages properly. Why do I say properly? Because technically speaking, institutions oftentimes meet the requirements. They provide documentation for forms and services in both official languages. But in most of these cases, languages were not properly used because of the lack of capacity, lack of the budgets, lack of professional language services, and lack of educational profiles for the language professionals. So in 2011 and 2012, there was an initiative to reform the Language Commission, which was there to observe the implementation of the law on languages. And as a result, Office of the Language Commissioner was formed in 2012. I took over my post end of 2012, beginning of 2013. One of our first attempts to analyze the situation on the ground, because the violations of the law on languages, or let's say lack of implementation of law on languages, were obvious. We try to identify the reasons for these events, and the reasons are still the same, just like pointed out in many reports of international organizations in the years before. The reason is a lack of capacity, a lack of budgets, lack of professionalism, and all this is reflected. It's even absurd that it's reflected through the fact that even some pieces of legislation are not properly translated. Even the constitution of Kosovo contains many mistakes in Serbian translation of the constitution. No need to mention how does that reflect in the field of implementation of the legislation once the legislation is applied. So we are still facing a lot of problems, and in the first day of our conference, after the presentations of my colleagues from Canada especially, I said, I wish I were in your shoes. To us, this is a really like a name that we will hardly ever reach. Actually, in our position, the best case scenario is to go like 30 years back to the situation in former Yugoslavia when everyone was happy. There are media in Serbian language in Kosovo. There are education system. There is education system in all levels in both languages. Education is also provided in other minority languages in Kosovo. In elementary and secondary level, the situation is not that bad as in 1999, but it's still far from good, and far from the situation when we can say it is good. I hope I have more than 1 minute or less. I really had to drastically cut my presentation prepared in Kosovo to mention some of the topics that I did mention today. But especially your presentation, Jan, moved me to say, for us, thanks God, there's EU. In most of the cases, I didn't manage to mention the role of the language commissioner. It is rather similar to the roles of the language commissioners in other countries. So I'm not gonna go there. We do recommendations, we do policy development, but the awareness of the political elite is not on that high level in order to accommodate for the needs of the linguistic communities. Or in some cases it can be excused by the higher political priorities and economic situation. Oftentimes our recommendations are adhered to only after we threaten that we will report it to the European Union. Actually, we report every year. We report to the European Commission about the developments in the area of community rights, including the language rights. And in the progress reports, European Commission often states the achievements that Kosovo needs to achieve in the next year in terms of language rights. And this is often used by us as a tool to achieve one of the goals of the language commissioner. And what are those goals? In my opinion, there was a debate in this forum and the day earlier in the Language Commissioner's Office about the importance of education, about the importance of raising awareness, about the balance between need for education in languages, teaching of languages of the communities in the schools, and the need for lobbying or raising awareness of the political elites. I really have to ask myself and the group some questions. Is there a real reconciliation without respect for languages and without achieving some bilingualism? Is respect for language possible without bilingual people? Because there was a statement that too many bilingual people can actually harm the language of the minority. But in Kosovo's case, the lack of bilingual people is actually endangering the whole process of implementing the law on languages, because we don't have academic educational profiles for interpreters and translators. We don't even teach the languages of the others in the universities or in elementary and high schools. Without education, we really can't build a sustainable, long-term sustainable base for implementation of the languages or for implementation of the idea of bilingualism in a country. Can institutions function without the people? Sorry, I'll take 30 more seconds. And can institutions function without bilingual people? Can we achieve this with the current system where education is segregated, basically, without immersion classes, without learning of languages in schools and in university? I don't think so. So I'm not going to make conclusions, but this is also a challenge to some of the statements presented here about goods or bads of bilingualism, about education in minority languages, and many other questions. So I took more time than I was given. Sorry, I thought my presentation was going to be 15 minutes. You can imagine.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Mladenovic. You've raised questions at the end that I'm sure will be coming back after the presentations. Thank you. I'm now pleased to introduce Mr. Wilpeta from Sri Lanka.
Good morning, everybody, and it is a great pleasure to be here amongst all of you. I know you all are very experienced professional in the field of languages, and whereas I'm a layman to the field, and I don't know I'll be able to live up to the expectation of the audience, but I will try my best to go through the presentation on behalf of Professor DMA Dissanayake, Chairman of the Official Languages Commission of Sri Lanka. The presentation I got last evening, so I hardly had any time to go through it, which was prepared by the professor himself. For the benefit of, I thank the organizing committee for inviting me here today, and it's an honor to be among so many professionals in this room. For the benefit of those who have not hear much about Sri Lanka, I will start the presentation with some kind of introduction. Okay. Okay, here. Unfortunately, I do not have a location map. I will explain. Sri Lanka is a small island nation situated just south of India, just off the southern tip of India. We are located at a strategically important location, which is roughly the halfway between Europe and Asia in the maritime Silk Route. I'm talking about ancient maritime Silk Route. And there is a very busy sea lane just south of Sri Lanka within the reach of 3 to 5 nautical miles. So you can imagine how strategically important location is. We are a small island, as I said. The size is about 65,000 square kilometers, and the population is about 20.4 million, out of which the 75% are Sinhalese, that's the majority, and we have roughly around 15% Tamil, which is the second largest ethnic group, and we have about 9% Muslims. So the religious wise, the 70% of the population is Buddhist, and 13% Hindus, again 9% Muslims. And so we are a multi-ethnic, multi-religious, and multicultural society. And throughout our history, we have been like that. Also, we have a very fascinating history. Most of you you might not be aware that we have about 2,500 years of written history. So the civilization goes back over 3,000 years or more. And as you know, we have just come out of a long, long conflict, ethnic conflict. So the conflict was close to 40 years long, and it was ended in 2009. And so we have lost good 40 years of development. So now we have a big task in catching up. So the economy is, after the war, doing very well. We have a GDP growth rate of between 7 and 8%, and even during the time of conflict, we had a good growth rate, like 5 to 6%. Having said all that, let me go through the slides now, so as you can see from the first slide, there is a bit of history, and Sri Lanka was populated by the Indo-Aryan came from North India in the 5th century BC, the Tamils from southern India came around 3rd century BC, and Muslims came much later in 14th century. And we have a bit of a kind of complex history since 15th century, because we were time to time under three European powers. In 1505, we were under at least the coastal areas of Sri Lanka. Certain coastal areas of Sri Lanka was under Portuguese, who came in search of spices and and treasures. And they ruled the coastal areas around roughly around 150 years, and then came Dutch in 1650s. So they chased the Portuguese away and ruled the same coastal areas for roughly 150 years. And the British came in around late 1700s. So they were there also ruling around 150 years. But the difference is, British were able to capture the whole island, and so by 1948 we regained our independence, and so after the independence we had a relatively a calm period until 1956. So that's where the conflict with regard to languages started. So the government at that time introduced the first National Language Official Languages Act. It was the Sinhala only act, and Tamil was named as official language, but national language in that act. So, which created a somewhat chaotic situation in the country. The Tamil people who lives in north and east did not like that. very much, and they started rioting and making protest. So in 1958, as a solution, the government included Tamil also as one of the official languages. But by that time, the damage has already been done. So with the with that Act of 1950, National Languages Act of 1956, the political disharmony among different ethnic groups, namely Sinhalese and Tamils, started growing, and gradually, by about late 70s, this disharmony grown into a military conflict, armed struggle, and the peak was like mid 1980s, and finally the armed struggle, the government was able to suppress the armed struggle. There was a group of terrorists known as LTTE, came from the Tamil-speaking minority. So with the defeat of the terrorist group, the conflict ended, and the conflict was never against the minority community, but it was merely a conflict between the legitimate government and a group of terrorists. So in between 1956 and 2009, there had been many attempts by different governments to implement national languages policy by way of different introducing of different acts in the parliament and constitutional amendments. So you can see some of uh, in this slide you can see how the conflict affected in the society and stabilization after the conflict. So as you can see in the slide, there were many destructions in all spheres of social life, and so if we talk about language accommodation in the forced conflict environment, as you can see in this slide, we have the 16th Amendment to the Constitution. It ensured the Sinhala and Tamil as the official language and English as the link language. And there are a number of legislative measures taken to ensure the language accommodation and implementation of the official language. But as you can see, we have the legal framework, but what was lacking in the area was the implementation and proper implementation. That was mainly due to the conflict, long-run conflict, and also lack of resources and lack of awareness. This is one of it is the same legislative base. So after the end of the conflict, there was awareness among the communities and even among the political leadership, and so the government understood the importance of creating an atmosphere for accommodation to all the languages, all major languages in Sri Lanka. So we reach out to Canada somewhere in 2010, I believe. With the support of the Canadian government, we started a project. And this project has done a tremendous work in this field, and I think they have started a translation unit which is fully operational now, and under this same project we started three bachelor's degree programs in three different universities leading to translation and interpretation, right? And also, most importantly, they have, with the Canadian assistance, we have prepared a roadmap, which is a long-term plan for next 5 years, in which we expect how we can. We can better implement the national languages policy, and in this regard, the National Official Languages Commission plays a key role, and so as you can see, their role can be categorized as advisory, monitoring, and educative investigation. And under these themes, there are four more sub themes, and so we are grateful to the government of Canada for implementing that project. And unfortunately, the project ended in this April. So we are hopeful that another project of this nature, in the same area, will be possible. And our friends here are working hard on getting the government approval for the next phase of the project. And in the post-conflict scenario, there is another development. The government in 2010 appointed a committee to look into the root cause of the conflict. Recommendations to avoid in the future conflicts. And this committee was named as Lesson Learned and Reconciliation Commission. Their broader objective was to find a way for national reconciliation. So they have made a number of recommendations in their final report relating to national languages, official languages also. I think now we have become, we have declared that the intention to become a trilingual nation because Sinhala, Tamil, and English are now taught in school levels. Earlier it was mainly either Sinhalese or Tamil or with English. Now the present generation of school-going kids are very fortunate. So they have the opportunity to learn all three languages from early childhood. So this is also one of the recommendations by the LLRC Commission, from bilingualism to moving to trilingualism. So these are some of the recommendations relating to national and official languages. And in this sphere we are in a better position since January this year, because we have a new government. There was a change of government by way of election through a presidential election. So the president minister, Mr. Maithripala Sirisena, he has a vision of accomplishing national reconciliation through good governance, and his government also shares the same vision. So there had been a lot of changes in Sri Lanka since January, and there had been a lot of new acts and amendments to the present constitution. Just last month we have the parliament has passed the 19th amendment to the constitution, which gives powers to independent commissions, including official languages commission. So with these legislative arrangements, I believe the National Languages Commission, as well as the other commissions, will function as independent bodies. And make recommendations for how we can go about this accommodation of languages in within the Sri Lankan society. I think, okay, with this, this is the final. I'm sorry for taking too long, but with this hope, I conclude my presentation, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wilpada. Just as a comment, the LLRC recommendations, if you could get a chance to go through them, there's a, as you've seen, you could not read them, but there's a, at least 10 of these recommendations that focus primarily on language, language issues, which is quite interesting. We have 10 minutes for questions, so I invite you to address your questions to either our presenters, using, obviously, the mic.
Carson Quill with the Office of the Commissioner of Official Languages. I have a question to both of you. Do you take any measures to measure the changes in support towards bilingualism language policy to see whether, I mean, you, Mr. Milinovic, you had mentioned that in the past attitudes were more favorable, and then you went through the conflict situation. Are you able to measure whether public attitudes are changing? And the same for Sri Lanka. I'd be curious to find out about both public opinion surveys on language, but also maybe some measures that you're taking to promote the learning of both languages, plus English, obviously. Thank you.
Hello. I think there are many measures to promote learning of the other language. So as I explained, now the school-going children have the opportunity to learn all three languages from beginning. Grade one onward, so which was not possible sometimes back, because it was only the mother tongue and the English link language. So now I think we have this opportunity. So with time, we'll have better results. I'm not sure whether we have any public opinion polls on language. I'm not aware. I'm sorry.
In Kosovo, we didn't have a poll on the acceptance. In Kosovo, we didn't have any polls on measurement on the acceptance of. Acceptance of the official languages by majority or minority. I have last year during the marking of the European Day of Languages in Kosovo, I've made a rather challenging statement to the authorities, saying that we need to introduce learning of Albanian language in Serbian schools and Serbian language in Albanian schools, at least as an elective. The reaction by the media, by social media, and by the politician told me that we are still not ready to accept such ideas. Some Serbian media has made the title, "We need to introduce Albanian language in Serbian schools." Stop. didn't even mention, or only later in the text mentioned that I said, and vice versa. Didn't even mention that I said this is the topic that we need to discuss at higher political levels, and this is something that we should fight for in the future. Of course, I didn't mean we should do it next school year. This is like a policy idea that will probably need 5 to 10 years to develop and implement. So it's on a rather long stick. On social media, of course, the reaction was because you usually have the trolls that that make a reaction and that are the loudest in reacting, and they were against the idea. And finally, deputy prime minister and some MPs and ministers from different ethnic communities said it's still too early to talk about the idea. I'm very confident this is the only way forward for Kosovo in order to establish a sustainable base for the implementation of the law, for integration, reconciliation, for real social inclusion, and therefore I will continue to lobby for the idea regardless of the resistance of the society.
And can I add something more? In Sri Lanka there is a political will and people took this as in positive way because learning others' language, we understand that it is important to move forward. And also, if you want to join the public service now, you have to have certain level of knowledge of the other language. It is a compulsory thing now, so it makes people to it motivates people to learn, become a bilingual or trilingual rather than,
If I may add, before my participation in one TV show in Kosovo, the TV station actually did a poll asking the participants whether they should include learning of the languages in the schools, at least as an elective, and around 100% of the people said yes. There is still reminiscence of the system from 20, 30 years ago, the effect that it had, and people do believe that their kids should attend schools and learn language of the surrounding community, language of the community, probably the best way to call it, in Kosovo case. And also I'll have to say the Kosovo institutions for implementation of the law on languages actually depend from the staff and from the capacities developed at the time. If we don't take actions right away, and this is why I fight so strongly for it, if we don't take actions right away, I'm afraid all these people will retire in 10 years and we'll be left with the people who learned the languages of the community on the street. And having in mind that they're not really in touch with one another, will be in a rather problematic area, problematic situation in a decade or so.
Just before closing, if I may add, if you allow me, Mr. Wilpeta, speaking of surveys and Karsten, I believe it's in 2007, the Official Language Commission did undergo a survey amongst about 40 or 50 institutions, mainly to ask questions with regards to awareness of the official language policy, attitudes within the institutions, the public institutions. And the same survey was conducted just a year ago using the same questions in the same institutions. And it's quite interesting because, yes, and the survey is available, there was a certain level of improvement, which is quite positive. I want to thank you very much to both of you for your generous cooperation and generous presentation this morning.